3 days later, and I see it all differently. There's a hidden language that the cloud and AI are bringing to light. A complex system of communication and connection between every living thing. A system that affects all of our lives. Just below the surface, seemingly beyond reach. Until now. As an environmental scientist by education and a climate resilience lead by trade, my passion lies at the intersection of innovation and our natural environment, which is exactly where I find myself today. For more than 100 years, the Chelsea Flower Show has been one of the biggest garden events in the world. Horticulturalists and hobbyists come from all over to celebrate innovative exhibits like this one, the Avenard Intelligent Garden. Here, technology and nature combine to transform how we understand the natural landscape. My colleague, Darren, and I are here to meet with Avenard's Devon Young and learn just how transformational this garden really is.
Hi, Devon. It's great to see you in the garden. And it must have been a huge undertaking because there's a large number of plants, but I can't see any technology.
Well, I'm so glad you said that. We have over 4,000 plants, but we've tagged 12 trees, and we have sensors in the soil, we have sensors in the water. There are sensors everywhere. You just can't see them.
I'm struck by this bringing together of human creativity in the garden and this AI technology. It's just a perfect match.
We wanted to show how sustainability and innovation can go hand in hand to help better look after our urban forests. 1 in 3 trees don't make it past their first year.
Wow.
We do a great job of planting trees, but we could do a much better job of looking after the ones we've already planted. Would you like to go and meet our landscape designer, Tom Massey?
Let's do it.
Hey, Tom.
Hi.
Meet Darren and Hannah.
Hey, Tom.
Nice to meet you, Tom.
Good to meet you.
So I'll catch you later at the pavilion.
Cool. Great. See you in a bit.
So this is an incredible garden you have here, Tom. How did you overcome the challenge of incorporating technology into it?
I think ultimately it's all about showing that nature and technology can coexist. Our gardens, our trees are under increasing pressure. There's so much innovation in technology, you know, AI, sensors. I think it's important to explore how they might help us in dealing with those challenges.
Maybe we can give you a little hand with this border here.
That'd be great. We've got not much time to go, so very helpful. So I'm just snipping out bits of, yeah, any dead heads or snaps, stems, yeah.
We'll give that a go. So, like, in terms of the amazing innovation you've brought to life, what can we take from this into the commercial and the public sector?
If you imagine a big developer planting 1,000 trees, each tree might cost up, you know, £1,000 or more. That, you know, there's a real value for them financially to preserve those trees, but also for the ecosystem services they bring. So if we can, you know, use technology in a way that can just give trees a better chance of thriving, it could have a massive impact.
Thank you for inspiring us today. You've got a lot of work left to do, so we're going to leave you to it.
Cool. Sounds good.
Thanks. Good luck with the show.
Thank you.
Welcome to our pavilion.
It is beautiful. But also it has the screens, which I believe is the first time that screens have been allowed in Chelsea.
We really wanted a way to showcase all of the data that we're capturing and have an at-a-glance view of what actions you can take to better tend to your garden.
But it's not just about the data visualization. There's an app, yeah, where we can actually interact and talk to the nature. And I'm looking out there and that willow tree is looking a little bit hot. Maybe we can ask it if it's feeling hot.
Definitely. Are you too hot?
I'm experiencing abnormal temperatures at around 16 degrees, which is uncomfortable. Look, this is just what this is all about, bringing data together so we can understand nature and take some action. So should we take some action and go and give it a water?
Let's do it.
Using technology to interact with a tree is amazing, which is probably one of the reasons this intelligent garden won gold at the flower show. But what if we could take the same pattern recognition to look beneath the surface of other aspects of nature, like the weather, which is critical to so many parts of our lives? My next stop is the Met Office, where scientists are using technology to mimic and model nature, helping them to make the seemingly unpredictable predictable.
But before we do that, here's my friend, biochemist, global STEM educator, Darian Nguyen, to explain the differences between simulation and emulation. Darian, catch!
How do you predict the future? If I were to flip this coin, what would you guess it would land on? Heads or tails? With high-performance computing, there are two ways of solving this problem. The first is emulation, or mimicking the real world. So if you know after watching a million coin tosses that it lands on heads 50% of the time, you can build a system that gives you the same outcome at a small cost without running the math. The other is called simulation, or modeling the real world. Now imagine flipping this coin under different wind speeds, angles, and heights, and using math to figure out what would happen next. However, simulation is much more resource intensive because every outcome is calculated from scratch. And that's what supercomputers do to predict things like the weather. Ah, tails.
Using a powerful supercomputer to simulate systems and accurately predict outcomes is just what they're doing at the UK's National Weather Service. The scientists here are building AI models that tap into the patterns of the weather, not just to see and hear it, but to understand it and learn from it. And there's no one better to introduce us to their work than the Met Office's Director of Science, Simon Vosper, who's agreed to meet me and kick off a tour of their world-class facility.
Given that the Met Office performs such an important service for individuals and organisations globally, I was just wondering, as the leader of that science piece, whether you could just talk us through how the monitoring and the modelling and the predicting works and what are the complexities involved in that?
It's complex. You're right, Hannah. So we're this organisation on a 24/7 basis. That data is ingested into our numerical weather prediction models through a complicated process called data assimilation. Then we run these big, complex models on supercomputers to produce the predictions we need to underpin our weather forecasts.
It's a lot to do.
You'll see we have quite a collection here. These are some of the historical tools we use to measure the atmosphere.
So obviously nature is inherently complicated and unpredictable.
That's what makes it so fascinating. In the end, it's all about reducing the uncertainty in our forecasts, whether that's for an hour ahead, weeks ahead, or right through to climate change timescales, where we're looking at decades or 100 years perhaps. It's a data problem in the end, so you need big computing power.
Yeah, I think I'm talking to Charlie about that.
Great.
Nice to meet you.
So Charlie, seems like it's really busy and an awful lot going on here.
This is really the beating heart of the Met Office. So we've got all the data being flowed into this room from the supercomputer, from all our modelling activities. All of the people that you see around you are experts in their domain. So really it's about situational awareness combined with expertise, combined with data.
So now we're sort of moving from a physical supercomputer into the cloud. How does that change what you can do here?
We reached a point whereby it becomes so massive, you begin to think, well, hang on a minute, this is a tool. Should we be expending so much time, effort on the tool, or should we be using the tool? What we've actually got now I'll call it a traditional scientific supercomputer. There's nothing traditional about it. It's actually integrated fully with a wider Azure platform, okay, which contains all this kind of really fast moving compute. Nobody else in the world has got a scientific supercomputer or anything like this scale, mm-hmm, fully bound into a public cloud environment anywhere. Wow. So it will enable some really new, exciting science and, mm-hmm, technology. But what the Met Office prizes most of all is actually the trust. It's, mm-hmm, been built up for 170 years. So however tempting, racing to some early conclusions on where this might go, that will be moderated by making sure that however we do it is super trustworthy.
And speaking of trust, I'm going to go and speak to one of the trusted faces of the Met Office. I'm going to go and speak to Alex now.
Great, that's this way.
Look at that, the cloud melts away and most of us will have a spectacularly sunny Saturday. Hannah.
Nice to meet you, Alex.
It's great to meet you. Shall I show you the other studio?
That'd be great, thank you. So Alex, we've been really lucky to get an end-to-end understanding of how the Met Office works, and we've just seen you do a forecast, and I guess that's what people are looking for. It's that trusted individual to sort of deliver the information on a daily basis, right?
Absolutely, you've got to have that human face. All the hard work's done by the supercomputer and the scientists, and I just get to tell people whether it's going to rain or not tomorrow.
Now you've got that migration to the cloud, how is that going to improve your job?
It's going to make things more accurate, it's going to make things more timely. You can name a storm 6 or 12 hours faster, then that gives more time for that information to get out to the public so people can actually take action. So it really will make a genuine difference.
Brilliant. So I'm off to the farm tomorrow. I was wondering, do I need my umbrella?
I think you'd be all right tomorrow. I stay high pressure, dry, fine, sunny, and actually temperature's a bit above average for the time of year.
Wow, that's good for the UK.
The way supercomputing can change our ability to understand the language of the weather is so impactful and will affect people all around the world. My experience in the Met Office reminds me that nature is something we're part of that plays a vital role in our well-being. For our next stop, we're going to bring this all together and see how farming, weather, and logistics impact our lives and meals on a daily basis.
But first, here's Darren with the buzz on supply chains.
How does an almond shortage in California affect labor markets in India? How do seemingly unrelated events cause chain reactions that ripple across the entire world? It's all because of supply chains. A supply chain is kind of like a beehive, a busy living network where everyone has a role. Forager bees collect raw materials, worker bees process and deliver goods, the queen bee keeps everything organized and running. If one group struggles, the entire hive can feel it. To warn about issues like this, bees use waggle dances to share information about food or danger. Today, supply chains rely on real-time data and AI as their modern waggle dance to go beyond reacting. Instead, to predict delays, adjust routes, and keep products moving even through strikes, bad weather, or global disruptions. Pretty sweet, eh?
Data gives us powerful insights into nature's complex interactions, but it's what we do with those insights that makes the real difference. At Mondra, they're using AI not just to fortify our food supply chain, but to optimise it as well. I'm here at a unique community farm in East London to talk with Tom Holden, Mondra's Chief Product Officer, about their efforts to create a better future for our food.
Well, thanks for the invite to the farm, Tom. This is an incredible space to talk about what Mondra does.
No, thank you, Hannah. This is such a large part of what we do. Using some amazing technology, we measure all of the emissions in the food and beverage products that we eat, all the way from farm to fork.
If I'm looking to buy lettuce next week to have in a salad, then you can understand how that process works.
Actually, the lettuce here belies the complexity of this incredible global food system that we all rely on. With over 70% of all the emissions of food actually here at the soil, from the fertilizer to the pesticide use to the irrigation, even down to the trucks that will move it to market. Everything needs to be accounted for to target our interventions to actually reduce the embedded emissions. It's a big, complicated picture, and we need that visibility that's only derived really through having technology and deep supply chain insight that we can really ensure that we can continue to deliver and enjoy the food that we all love. Should we go and see a little bit more of the farm?
That would be amazing.
This is one of my kids' favourite places to come and visit in London.
So one of the ways that you're making this possible for your customers is using digital twins for the supply chain.
Well, so digital twins were almost a byproduct. If you're doing good quality life cycle assessment, you need to be looking at every single transformation effect through the entire supply chain. What we are left with is a transformative data asset, enabling us to connect through to the farm. For those further downstream who are building products, they can have unparalleled insight into the ingredients that actually go into them. A big part of what we do is working with pre-existing data, but to need to elevate the data. And we use technology, including Azure AI Foundry, to actually enable us to create the digital twins and then work iteratively to improve them over time.
So we're seeing technology advance at breakneck speed at the moment, Tom. How does this really impact on your service and mission at Mondra?
So we see it as a massive accelerator. We're just so excited about the next stage of our journey. And for us, that's going to be bringing AI into this incredibly complicated space of multidimensional decision making, which is required to not only deliver net zero, but to ensure that we keep putting the food that we all enjoy on the plates.
Throughout our lives, we are constantly reminded of the power of technology to change how we see the world. From urban forests, to the weather, to our global food supply chain, we are on the precipice of a new revolution, one where AI, science, and the cloud can come together and transform our ability to interact with the planet. The signs and signals of nature are all around us, always have been. And now, with powerful tools like AI, we can better understand them.